Today we're taking a look at how you can create captivating scenes and animations like these for your projects, presentations, and portfolios. And to do that, we're gonna utilize D5's newest version 2.6. So let's get started. So go ahead and open up D5 and open up your project. In my case, I have a SketchUp model of an urban plaza that I then brought into D5 and added vegetation, materials, and textures to. Now, in case you're wondering what my process was for adding textures, people, and vegetation into a model like this, be sure to check out a recent video I did that covers those aspects. Now to start, the first thing we wanna do is take a minute and think about our model as a whole and what we're looking to accomplish from it. In most cases, this is going to be to tell a story and to showcase your ideas. Now, a really easy way to do this is to break down your model into three different types of shots. The first of which is our establishing shots. These are 1 to 2 images that showcase the overall site and give an introduction to it. In general, this could be an entrance, a focal element, or a bird's eye shot that showcases our space in its entirety. Then we have our supporting shots. These can be 2 to 3 images that help reinforce the established shot and help talk about some of the specific design areas that you have going on. Then finally, we have our detail shots. This could be another 2 to 3 images that talk about each one of those spaces that we've showcased in a little bit more detail to help fully tell our story. So let's do one together, starting with the establishing shot that's going to introduce our site. And for me, in this model, that's gonna mean bringing us down to the entrance to the park. So let's head on over to the left corner and bring it down to just about eye level. The reason we wanna be down around eye level for these shots is so that way it still seems plausible for you to be in and looks natural to your eye. Because if you were too high or too low, it just would look a little bit too unrealistic and it wouldn't give the viewer the impression as if they were actually standing there and looking into your design. And speaking of realistic to the eye, let's make sure we are in perspective mode. To do that, make sure you either hit F8 or head on over to the view panel in the camera settings at the top right and turn on 2-point perspective. We wanna make sure we do this anytime we're down at eye level, so that way all of our lines are truly vertical, which is what looks most realistic to us in real life. Now, after we're in the general area that we wanna be in, let's think about our composition now. Composition is really important and is often overlooked in our field, but it does a lot for helping guide the viewer and helping the design and image feel very balanced and feel like it's a real place that you're captivated by. Now, I definitely encourage you to look into some composition types, especially landscape ones in your free time, but let's start with one that everyone pretty much knows, the rule of thirds. So to do that in my viewport here, I'm gonna adjust the view until our focal element here is on the left third of our image. And you can see with just that move alone, it already looks so much better. Now to build upon this, the next thing I would look for is I would shift my focus away from that center focal piece and see what's going on at the extents and how we can make sense of it all. And for me, I have one element that I would like to play a little bit on, and that's gonna be the leading lines that are created by this line of apartments here on the left side. So what I'm gonna do here is I'm going to adjust my view just a little bit until that line of apartments is directly on the extent of our page, and it's gonna create this really nice viewing plane down the line as well as looking to the right down into our arrival space. That way it leaves us this really nice scene that's gonna capture every element we're intending to capture without revealing too much. We're gonna be able to see what's going on in the arrival in the foreground. Then we're gonna be guided towards the park and that focal element sculpture in the background. And we're gonna leave wondering what's inside of there, and it's gonna hopefully engage the audience to wanna know what's inside there in your design. So I feel pretty good about this, so let's add it to the list, and then let's jump into the post-production settings and get cranking out that render for you. And to start off, I really love to use D5's presets. I think they have some really great settings and they can take care of the bulk of your kind of color grading and vibe without having to know everything about, you know, post-production settings and tweaking things. The studio icon is located on the top left and it's a little purple circle, and that will open up all of your presets for you. Like I mentioned, they're really great and they've been carefully selected by professional artists to optimize and have the best kind of results without having to do much. My recent favorite right now to play with has been the exterior aerial fog. So let's download it, double click on it, and get it into the model. Now from here, let's look at the environment tab on the right and start to edit the effects slightly to adjust to our environment and to our setting. Now the first thing I always like to start with is our sun. So let's scroll down to our sun settings and change the directions from follow HDRI to custom and set our altitude. Changing the altitude is very important as this will affect our overall shadows on the site. And as a rule of thumb, longer shadows generally look more realistic, So that means we want to make sure that the sun is a little bit lower in the sky to achieve that. For this, I pretty much stay anywhere between 10 and 40. Then next, I'll look at changing the azimuth. This setting will change where the sun is in relation to our sight. A good starting point for this is to have the sun facing directly behind you or slightly off center on your left or your right. That way we perfectly illuminate our sight and we don't have a muddy image. Of course, there are exceptions to this if you're trying to do a sunset or a sunrise render where you need to have that sun in the foreground, but in general, it's always better to keep those behind you. Then after I get the sun in a location that I'm feeling happy about, I'll then start to go up the line in the settings to further tweak out our image. And as you go up, the first setting you'll see is the color temperature of the sun. This will change it from, you know, a deep orange, red to a blue. I'm gonna leave it as is for now, but here's where you would go to change that. Then we have our sun disk radius. This setting essentially changes the harshness of the shadow. So a lower radius is gonna result in hard shadow lines, whereas a larger value will have shadows much more blended within each other. This definitely varies on your own style and how you like the shadows to look, but I typically stay between 1 and 4 on the scale. Then the last item in our sun tab is the intensity. This is gonna affect how bright our image is. So 0 will be for a night render, and then the latter is gonna be really bright. Now, in all my testing, I don't think I've ever gone higher than 5. And I most often hang between about 0.5 and 2. Next above, we have our HDR settings. This would be where you'd come to change that sky and play with the effects of the specific sky background. So if you click on that HDR eye, you're gonna get a bunch of different options or your own chance to import them. In case you don't like any of the presets that they have listed in here, they also have a whole other library in the Assets tab that you can choose from. They really do have a really great library, so I encourage you checking this out because you can really get pretty much any render idea all without having to leave this app, which is what one of my favorite parts of it is right now. But then once you have a sky you like, make sure you toggle on the filter option so we can play around with it a little bit more. First, we can look at the skylight. The skylight is gonna impact our overall brightness of our image, but it's not gonna be as harsh as impacting our sun. It's gonna make a little bit less of an impact. And then the background is going to change the color of the sky. Pulling the slider down or to the left is gonna produce a deeper blue sky, whereas pulling it to the right or increasing it is going to create a really bright, sunny, white sky. And then lastly, we have our rotate tool, which will rotate our sky for us, which is gonna be a good place to come if you wanna find a specific sky or part of the sky that we wanna make sure is in our background. Now from here, if you started with a preset and changed the sky, you probably don't have to do anything else, but let's run through the rest of the settings just in case you wanna do some further tweaking down the line. So let's start by looking at some of the different weather effects you can use to really enhance your scene and environment. So starting with fog, this is gonna be one of the easiest ways you can add a little bit more of a mood and a feeling and ambiance to your site without having to do much. You of course need to be careful not to overdo it, but I like to use fog a lot and I generally like to keep it very far in the distance so that way it fades out what's going on in the background a bit, which looks a little bit more realistic to what you would see in the natural environment. Now you can control a bunch of settings below, and keep in mind that when you're doing this, all of the settings kind of play directly off of the sun. So depending on if you're gonna change your sun or not, it might impact how that fog looks. So you might need to go back and forth between the two to get it looking the way you want it. Then after fog, we have wind that we can add to our scene. This is gonna be really good if we're trying to create a video because it's gonna add just a little bit more of movement subtly to your environment, which is great. But if you're not going to be using a video, then don't worry about this. And lastly, we have some precipitation options. I haven't used the snow so far, but the rain is really awesome. It's a really easy way to break up the materiality of the foreground and materials in the base, and can also add a little bit more of reflections to your design, which might look a little bit better. So I'm actually gonna add this into our shot because I'm kind of going for a more foggy post-rain environment that is, you know, the sun's peeking through. So I think turning on the rain, but turning off the actual precipitation and just having the puddles is what I'm gonna go for. Now, after this is done, if you wanted to keep going, we should head on over to the effects tab where we can control our color grading and LUTs. Now, starting at the top, as I mentioned, you can have your own LUT or choose from a series of presets. What this does is it essentially applies kind of a holistic color grade to your image without having to go through and actually specifically create them yourself. So let's say you've added a LUT, or in our case, we already have a LUT included with the preset that we used, and we want to just make a little bit more adjustments, we would then go down below the LUTs and look at all of the different options that we could choose from. This works just like Lightroom or Photoshop Camera Raw Filter, and you pretty much kind of work your way from the bottom to the top, in my opinion, and you kind of just slide and see how every different effect impacts your design, and always stop it when it feels like it's in the right spot. But in general, if you're ever feeling like your exposure's off or something's weird going on, head on over to the effects tab and play around with the local exposure or, you know, the surface exposure to hopefully hone in your result for you. But once you're feeling good about it, we can then export our image. Now to do that, make sure we're in the image tab, and then let's run through the list of settings on the bottom just to double check and make sure that our output is what we want. So let's make sure you're in image mode, not panorama mode. Then let's make sure our focal length is somewhere between 20 and 30 millimeters, as this is what is most realistic to the eye. Then let's select our output aspect ratio, the size of the file, and choose our format to export to. And you're all set, and you can wait to see what your final result is. Now, essentially what you've done is you've created the first render of a series of renders that have the same look and feel to it. So all you need to do from here is navigate to your next shot in your list, add it to your scene, and then just tweak kind of some of the global settings, like where the sun is and the placement of the sky. So that way the shadows and lighting all feels real and like you spent time on it. And that's gonna be the best way to go about adding more and more images to your design. Now, D5 also has some other great features that can really help improve your post-production settings and also just improve your workflow and speed of actually doing this task. And the first of which is going to be the AI atmosphere match. This can be found with a little diamond and stars around it in the effects tab. And what this does is it allows you to import a precedent image that you really like, and it will take that atmosphere and put it into your site and apply it to it to hopefully achieve the same look as the one you're inspired by, which is awesome. It essentially gives you a custom preset for whatever you want, which is really awesome for having general variability in design and workflow and post-production rendering looks. And then outside of the general stills, there's also some really great video features that you can use that make it really easy to incorporate into a design. So let me show you how to do that really easily in the video tab. Now you'll notice when you open up the video tab, you'll have a series of templates that you can choose from on the right side. Now these are absolutely awesome because you can simply just select it on your scene and then it's gonna automatically import that video for you. And then you'll be able to edit it, edit the path, edit how long it goes. It's just a really amazing preset that you can apply without having to spend the time to figure out the right move and the right camera movements, as it's all here for you. It's great for me because I've never really been one to use videos before in a rendering format. And by having these templates, I actually am using it a ton more now because I don't have to spend time trying to figure out the movement. And in addition to adding a still and turning it into a video, you can also add a walkthrough incredibly easy in D5. You can either have all of your shots already added to your scene and then just add them into the video tab, or you can actually do it manually by just moving around, add a scene, move to the next spot, add a scene, and repeat the process till you have your end result you want. Then of course, if you wanna make tweaks or change it slightly, you can add and edit the path. And inside of that edit path, you'll be able to change the way the camera looks, as well as manipulate the pathing by selecting on the purple diamond points to choose and change the way your camera moves around the different shots. So play around with it until you have something that you like, and then simply just choose the format and export it. So I know I threw a lot of information at you at once. So if you have any questions, be sure to reach out, drop a comment below, and I'll do my best to help answer any question that you have regarding post-production, video creation, animations, and just general stills and all those things with visualization. But as a wrap up, here are some of the photos and videos that I created with the settings we just explored, and I'm actually really happy with the results. Overall, I've just been really impressed with D5 lately, and I think every new update just has more and more great features to choose from. They have tons of resources, assets, and other things that are just incorporated into it, which makes it really easy to use as an all-in-one platform without having to bring it into Photoshop after or do these all other things just to make your render look different. I also think it's really affordable from a cost point, and it's really beginner friendly as well, which is really great when considering using a product like this. So that said, I do have a code to get a free trial of the Pro version. If you want that, check the link in the description below to get started. But anyways, that's all for today's video. So if you did enjoy it, be sure to drop a like and share it with a friend who wants to learn more about landscape architectural visualizations. And if you're new here and you want to learn more about what landscape architecture is, then be sure to check out my channel for more content. And as always, thank you for listening. And here's a couple videos that I think you will find helpful next. Peace.